What is up, everyone? Welcome back to another episode of Convincing Creatives Panda Bear It Edition. Today, we have Panda herself in the room, in the building, in the Zoom call, whatever you want to call it. It's a Zoom call. But yes, we have Panda, played by Melissa Cowan Rattray, here on the podcast. Melissa is a local actor here in Raleigh, North Carolina. She's acted in a couple of short films. She does modeling. She's done a variety of things. She is also on TikTok now. We have a great little conversation about TikTok later into the podcast episode. But definitely check this one out. It is super interesting just for the fact that, as I mentioned, Melissa plays the role of Panda, and Panda is a literal panda in a panda bear mascot costume, hence the name of the film, Panda Bear It. Being in a mascot costume for hours and hours on end is obviously challenging because it is padded and it is a panda, so you know it's hot. It's North Carolina, so even though we filmed in October and November, you're dealing with random temperatures in the 70s and 80s, even that late into the year. Because North Carolina. So it's obviously a lot of fun, though. She had a great time. She talks about that as well in the interview. And I think it's just interesting because she did such a good job of conveying, the nuanced emotion of the film, because Panda in the film represents our main character, Camus's subconscious. So, you know, Panda will be doing something and no one else in the scene, but Camus can see Panda doing it. So that leads to all kinds of comic opportunity. And Melissa took a lot of advantage of that with physical comedy, you know, waving her hands in the air, joking around, but also kind of being a sombering, almost ghost-like presence in the film and other more serious scenes where she kind of hangs back. And so we talk about balancing that comedy and drama and when to kind of, you know, lean forward into one or the other. So without any further ado, here is my interview with Melissa for Convincing Creatives Panda Bear It Edition. Thanks, y'all. Check it out. We have Panda herself on the show, Melissa Cowan Rattray. Welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. Thanks for being here. It has been a few months since we concluded filming with Panda Bear It. Gosh, it feels like a long time ago now because the COVID and everything else in the world going on right now. But I just feel it's exciting to talk about all these different cast members' process for, you know, getting into the film and preparing and then just general acting. You had probably the most interesting role of everyone because you were inside of a literal panda bear mascot costume.
Right.
In North Carolina where, you know, we didn't film in the summer, but it was still kind of hot and, you know, you just had to deal with all that fun stuff. So before we get to Panda, I just want people to get a sense of who you are. So could you tell us a little bit about how you got your start in acting and creativity and all that here?
Okay. So, well, for me, I've always wanted to be an actress. I usually do like little small plays at home. Like I'm just in my own little world, you know, I'm like the star of my own show here at home.
Yeah.
But so how I really got into it here is I was invited to a birthday party and I met a group of people that happened to do fashion shows and stuff like that. And they invited me to a fashion show. And from there, I met different people. And I started to learn about the castings and how you get into them and making submissions, because before I was like, I don't know how to do this thing. You know, I don't know how to do it. Like at home, like, yeah. You know, I'm a star at home, but like out there in the real world, I don't know how to do that. So meeting them, I was like, oh, okay. So that's all I have to do. So I started working on doing submissions. And I have done tons and tons and tons of submissions to the point where I was like, man, this is just not for me. It's just not for me. It's not going anywhere. And so I did a submission once and they were casting for, it was a internet educational video. So I did the submission for that and I actually got it the very first time. I was like, oh my god, I'm an actress.
That first role is always special. Yeah.
Yes. I was like, oh, that is me. And so I was so anxious to like see myself on camera. Like, you know, yeah. I record myself with my own phone, but to like it done professionally, it's a whole nother, you know.
Yeah.
That's basically how I got started. And, but that was not it for me. And it's still not it for me, you know? So I started doing more castings and, still get a lot of no's. I would get booked for a lot of background / extra roles. And I'm like, I don't really want to do that. Like, I feel like I'm very talented. You know what I'm saying? I'm talented.
You want to be but, given the speaking roles.
Yeah, yeah. Like, let me talk. Like, yeah. I got a mouth. So I was like, I don't want to do that. And so, like, low-key, I would be, like, a little discouraged, mm-hmm. no lie. But, like, I'm very determined, and I know my goals, so I never stop. Like, I still do submissions. I still go out there, show up in the background, like, mm.
Yeah,
you know, do but, so yeah, that's basically it. I still do it.
Yeah. So I guess, like, switching gears, like, let's talk about Panda. So with Panda, mm-hmm. I mean, you brought Panda to life. I just have to say this. It's like, I loved watching Panda come to life because, you know, it's hard because when you're acting, so much acting is the face and your eyes, right. And just all that. And with what you had, you were wearing a giant mascot costume of a panda bear. You couldn't see your face. I mean, you even had like the body, the fur and all that, the tail and I mean, everything. So, you know, how did you prepare for that? And like, how did you make Panda come alive? Because I think you did so much with like, you know, the gestures and it, funny stuff and serious stuff. Cause you know, the character of Camus in the storyline, you know, he sees this panda bear that no one else sees. And it's sort of a representation of his own mind and his depression and things he's going through and grieving. But there's also some comedy because sometimes Panda's like, oh, you're not going to go do this thing. Let me make fun of you because you didn't even try, you know? So like, how did you get into that mind space to kind of bring Panda alive through the costume?
So let's just make one thing clear. I could not see anything.
It was so hard costume. To, yes. You did so good despite that.
I wear glasses and I couldn't have the glasses with the mask on. So I was like, I can't see anything in this. And that one scene where we were, where I was running, I was like, Lord, please don't let me fall. Please don't let me fall.
we were like trying to be like the people who work at the airport with the plane, like directing the traffic. We were trying to like clear a path for you and like, yeah.
Yeah. But to, honestly, I feel like whatever role it is, I have to be ready for it mentally. Yeah. And then just being Panda, it wasn't hard because I'm silly. I'm naturally silly. So that part wasn't for me. And then I know when to be serious. So it's like, I had no problem switching gears at any time, but, okay. Yeah. So I was like, it's just me being Melissa. So, it wasn't hard. I just feel like in a way, you would say I'm an amateur actress, but I consider myself professional because if you give me a role and you tell me I have to be a dog in that role, oh, I'm going to be the best dog you've ever hired. You best believe that. So I just knew this is the role that I had to play, and I'm going to make it happen, hot or can't see. Here I am.
Yeah. And you did. I mean, you had the full dedication. Next time we'll have to film in the snow because maybe then the costume will be warm. Yeah. It won't be so hot. And I mean, that's the thing that's crazy. We did film a few days in like November and it was still kind of hot. That's like how North Carolina is sometimes. But yeah, you did good, I think, because like you were able to find the moments of humor a lot of times in the like sad kind of you know, there's like almost like depression with Camus, and so you know, he was sad, he was alone in his room, and then Panda was sort of this energy of, hey, you need to get off the couch, you need to go take a shower, you need to go write a song, you need to go to work, you know. So like, how did you find that that drive to be the motivation? Because it's sometimes it's hard to get people to do things if they don't want to do it.
That is me, naturally. I'm always that shoulder. So, like, it's no problem. Like, okay, so I know you're down, but, buddy, this is what's going on. We got to do this now. So, naturally, I'm always trying to encourage someone, you know, just trying to be there for them. And so that came naturally, too. So, like, that whole role fits perfectly because I'm like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all of that.
Yeah. So when you saw the movie and you had the like text underneath with like what Panda was saying, was it weird to see? Because on set, we never had you really say the lines. We knew mm-hmm. what you were going to be saying, and that's how you were gonna like, you know, react physically with, you right. know, Panda, you know, waving arms in the air or whatever. But was it interesting to see that like text and then kind of the way it fit?
It was really different, to be honest.
Yeah.
Because you're like, okay, so you're watching it and you're like, okay, so this panda thing, huh? And then you see the subtitles, like, oh, okay, I yeah. get it.
And then there's the little like noises that go with it kind of to
like, okay, so she definitely can't speak. So, okay.
Right. Yeah. And that's kind of the way when I was writing it, I wanted it to be almost like, you know, everyone has that conscience in their head that tells them, you know, the right thing to do, whether they do it or not. But
right.
you know, it's like that voice in the back of your head, and you, it's not something that speaks in, you know, English or any other language. It's just your own brain. So like, that's kind of why I liked using the subtitles, kind of to keep it internal to Camus. And I think another thing that you did well was, and it was interesting to watch, you know, as the director, because, you know, I was telling you guys about the scene, but a lot of times you would be almost copying ways of Camus. You know, if Camus was sad, you know, you would slump your shoulders and kind of be like that. Or, you know, there was the scene where, you know, he was on the phone at night playing video games, and you were in the corner watching him, you know, cancel some plans on his friends. And you're like, how do you even have friends at this point?
Like, you're like, how do you do that? Like,
right, right. And then he doesn't even care. Did you ever like kind of consider the fact that it was almost like any personal experience to draw from? Cause I know Panda doesn't ever speak, but also Panda is like that person who's really his best friend at the end of the day. Like, cause not a lot of people would always care for him at that point in the movie. So it was really almost Panda, even though Panda was that voice saying, hey, go to work, get up, put your pants on, you know, be an adult, do the right thing. You know, leave the apartment, you know, how did you kind of find that, the humor in it too? Cause you sometimes did this thing that was funny, that like you would like kind of joke with him. And make him like not feel bad, but you did a good balancing between the comedy and the drama, because life is not always one way, you know.
Yeah, like it's not the end of the world. So for me, I just felt like it would be more interesting to the viewers, yeah. because they would kind of still see what he's going through and then understand that, okay, so this panda is really supporting him, but she's like, you know, funny at the same time. So it really wasn't. It really wasn't hard to kind of find mm-hmm. that balance there. And then just being able to be silly too at times, it was just like, yeah, this is just great. And then also to help him to feel a little more comfortable, because it got a little tense at times. So it yeah. helps him to be a little more comfortable.
Yeah. And then another thing, you know, I won't spoil the twist in the film, but you may or may not play a different character at the same time as Panda, technically. So how did you balance that kind of role where, you know, you're almost being someone who really cares for Camus, but also being Camus at the same time?
So, based on what happened and the whole story and what goes on, and knowing that that part is really, it's really a sad part. I just basically just kind of changed gear for a sec.
Mm-hmm.
And being a mom, it happens a lot. You have to know when to be that fun and then be like, no.
Mm-hmm.
So, It really wasn't hard. Now I'll say it was very interesting, because knowing what is going on, and you got to like remember, okay, so this is not the role I'm playing right now, so I have to do this part like this.
yeah, you almost had to do two things simultaneously, and it was interesting. It was very interesting to see that. Another thing I found kind of fascinating too was like later in the film, there's that scene with the farmer, and you know, him and Camus and the farmer are having this really, you know, serious, kind of sad conversation together. And then Panda the whole time, because she's sort of the, you know, it's hard to say without, I don't want to spoil the film, but she's kind of a part of that conversation in a way. And she's sitting in the back listening for, you know, almost 10 minutes. That scene is a long scene. You know, how do you do that where, you know, you're in the costume, it's hot, and you're trying to focus, but at the same time, you're in Panda mode, because, like, again, you did such a good job, because it was like Panda looked so sad, even though, like, you know, she's, it's a costume, you can't see it, but like she just looks so sad, and you felt sad for Panda. Like, how did you kind of find that way?
So I just think about it. I was like, okay, so you can't use your face, and usually your facial expression would show what you're feeling. And I was like, how can I show that this is what I'm feeling without actually doing it? So I kind of like, I kind of used my body language. Just like I put myself in a zone where I'm like, I'm down, and be like, okay, so you remember this part of the script. So like, go back to it and feel what he's feeling, feel his pain. And so that's basically how the feelings will come across with the body language in that costume.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's the biggest challenge. Like, I remember when I was casting for the film, I was like, you know, Camus is the main character, but really the film, it all comes down to Panda, a lot of it, because it's how you look at Panda and see their relationship together. Could you talk a little bit about like working with Camus? Because I know like y'all two had really good chemistry together. You know, it was almost that like comedy, you know, buddy drama kind of comedy at the same time. It was very interesting.
It was really nice working with him. And I think what actually helped us with the other scenes is that we kind of talked about our family.
Yeah.
And then kind of learn more about each other. So it kind of helps too, because funny thing is, similarly to the actual film, there are events in both of our lives where we can actually relate to it. So it really wasn't hard. And then at times he was very uncomfortable, so I had to like be silly to let, you know, like loosen him up a little bit, loosen him up. It wasn't hard, just because we kind of got that chemistry where we actually talked about, you know, ourselves individually or family, and then we're like, okay, cool, we're good, it's all right, it's okay, we're good now.
yeah it's like y'all were able to be vulnerable with one another. And I think it showed in the performance, because when you were on screen together, you two played off of each other, you know, sometimes based on the script, but sometimes just improv. Like, you know, he would be like, well, fine. And then you would be like, well, fine. And then it would just be, you know, it would almost be like a competition to see between the two of you who would do the funniest thing or the weirdest thing. Right. And I loved that, because it kind of allowed the scene to feel like, you know, he's known Panda his whole life, because he is Panda, kind of, you know, it's a part of his own subconscious. And so it made me feel like, you know, Panda's not just something that showed up one day and he's, you know, avoiding it. It's really, he's been avoiding himself for many years. And, you know, it's, I think because you felt comfortable together, that was able to read through the screen, you know. And I think it was really interesting. So I guess going forward, you know, based on Panda Bear, what was some lessons that you learned from the experience? I mean, I know it's a unique role, because typically you're not going to be in full costume, but what did you learn from the process of maybe being in full costume that you could take into anything else?
That you never know what you're going to get into.
That is very true.
Like, honestly, you never know. But I would say the fact that it was a lot of cast members, and just feeling like they were family, just feeling like everybody was, you know, family. You can actually get that from strangers.
Yeah.
Not that I didn't know, but it kind of like sealed the deal, you know, like, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's actually true, because it's happening here with all the other characters in so many ways. You know, we've all had some type of bond. And that was really special. And I was like, okay, this is going to make this movie even more bomb because, you know, everybody's like getting along and it's really like the family that is portrayed in the film.
Yeah. 100%. Yeah. Well, and I think too, like, you know, the role of Panda is interesting because it's kind of a hook that gets people to be like, oh, that movie, what is that about? You know, cause you see Panda Bear It, it has a panda. That's just different from many movies. You know, it almost reminds me of like something you could see on like, I don't know, TikTok or Facebook or something, like just a dancing panda in a mascot costume. Cause it's just so out there and random. Could you maybe talk about, like, I think today in society and culture, like sometimes there's just so much information and so much, you know, videos and films and TV and everything. It's hard to even decide what to watch and what's worth the time. I think what might be interesting about Panda is that it seems silly at first, cause you're like, okay, it's this, you know, random mascot in a costume that has to be a comedy, but really it's sort of I won't say a trick, but at the end of the day, it's more of a drama. What do you think about that? Kind of like you put that out there for people to come in the door. And then once they're in the door, they're like, oh wow, this film is actually, you know, a couple other things. And I think a lot of that is because of the way you and Camus and everyone was able to kind of bring the balance of comedy and drama.
Watching it and so being in it and watching it is like two completely different things because
yeah.
you're not and you actually do get emotions from it, all type of emotions from the film. So I feel once they start it, they're gonna be like hooked, like, okay, I want to see what happens next because I'm curious. Okay, what's going on? Oh, that is funny. Okay, so, oh, but it's really not funny. Oh, wait, okay, so, you know, yeah. So it's all over. So I think it's actually something that would actually pull an audience because the suspense is there at all times. It's always there. So you're like, okay, you know, you're like on edge. Okay, yeah. Okay, okay, what's next?
Yeah. Well, and that's the thing. I haven't obviously been able to show it in like a big movie theater or anything, but, you know, I've sent it to the cast and crew, some family, just so they could look. And that's what everyone has said. They're like, well, at the very least, we just want to find out what's the mystery of Panda. Like, who is Panda? Why is Panda here? What, you know, why is it only Camus sees Panda and no one else does? So mm-hmm. I feel like it's those little mysteries that kind of, like you said, people, it gets them started in the first few minutes to kind of say, oh, well, maybe this is a deeper story than I even imagined at the beginning of the movie. And I think that's what's interesting about, you know, people and acting and everything is you're able to convey, you know, so much more than just what's on the surface. So, yeah, I think that's definitely super interesting.
Yeah, it was kind of like one of Dick Wolf's film where his series, like, okay, ooh, next episode, I want to see it. I got to see this. I have to see this. Okay, man.
it keeps you slightly invested just to say, okay, one more time, one more. Yeah. And I think too, I'm curious to hear, you know, I'd love for people to watch the film once, but I'd be very curious to have people watch the film twice because I think once you know the twist at the end, you could rewatch the film and catch things that hint to it the whole time that maybe, you know, people wouldn't notice the first time because, you know, like I said, Panda steals the show the first time, you know, it's a loud character in a costume. So, you know, I think that's what's interesting about it. Cool. So this is kind of the last question I ask everyone for the podcast is what is your favorite memory from set, from making Panda Bear It? Maybe it's a funny memory or whatever, but we moved so fast. That's kind of what I always think is like, we did so much in such a short amount of time. But we always were very focused on like the end result.
I loved, this with, Marcus and Grandma.
Yeah.
And, Camus at that table and, a scene with the other character and, Camus, only because it was just a lot of, it was just hilarious, things that were being said.
There was a lot of funny dialogue in improv. Yes, I think that's a great memory because, you know, like we stuck to the script, but we always were allowing ourselves the freedom to say, okay, well, what would happen if we tried it one more way with a little bit of a twist? And so I think it allowed for some experimentation on set. Yeah. And I also love the part with you and the cow.
Oh yeah, my buddy. I laughed at that part so hard.
I know. We didn't even plan that.
Right.
What happened was when we went to Lake Waccamaw, which is, you know, a kind of more rural part of North Carolina in the East. And, you know, we were filming on this farm for this large amount of scenes that were happening at this farmer's house. So before he meets the farmer, you know, there's cattle and horses running around and, you know, livestock. And, you know, we originally had nothing with really the animals, you know, they were just supposed to be in the background, but we had this cow that kept coming up to the car. And I think it's because we had the Flaming Hot Cheetos and yeah, I think really the cow wanted some Cheetos. Yeah. And that's the thing. Panda was always eating Cheetos in the film. Panda was always hungry. Cause it was like the subconscious of Camus, cause he wasn't really eating. He was, you know, hiking alone in the woods. So I think that's sort of what that represents. But it was funny because you had those Cheetos and the cow came up to you and I was like, wait, we got to get the camera and film it. Okay. Yeah. That was like one of the best improv moments I think we had, of the cow just coming up and checking us out what we were doing.
Yeah,
the cow wanted its IMDb credit, I think. So
okay, and he had it.
Now he got it. Yeah. It.
There was also one where Panda was waving, and it's a small scene, but the whole film, that part was hilarious.
Yes.
Because that farmer boy.
Oh, man.
Is something else.
He was cracking us up. He was making us laugh.
He was something else. Oh, yes, I really like that one.
I love Eric. Yeah, yeah, he is a funny guy. He is great. He is able to balance, just another person that can balance the comedy and the drama like super well. Yeah. Cause like we would come out of that dramatic scene and then he would just be joking. And then we would go right back into it. And then he would be like, you know, crying. And I'm like, man, like that's just dedication. It's great. Awesome. Well, Melissa, thank you again for coming on the podcast and chatting with us. This was so much fun. Where can people like find you online if they want to keep up with what you're doing and, you know, your work in acting?
I am on Facebook as Melissa Cowan Rattray. I have, that is my actual model/film page. And then I'm just on regular Facebook as Melissa Rattray. I'm also on Instagram as Lunelli_GoGetta, but it's not Getter, it's Getta. And recently I started TikTok. You can't tell me nothing.
I love TikTok. Okay. I went viral on TikTok the other day and it was crazy. Yeah, I got like a million views on this TikTok. All it was,
I have to go find you.
I'll send it to you. All it was me cutting a watermelon. And there was the meme about like everything is cake. So I was like, let me cut this watermelon. What's it going to be? And then everyone thought it was cake, but it was just a watermelon. Like I put 20 seconds of effort. I put no effort or thought into it. And I'm like, of course this gets all the attention. I'm like, it's just so funny.
Those are usually the ones that you don't expect.
Yeah.
Do it.
Yeah. But I'm glad that you're on TikTok.
I am. So yeah. So it's TikTok. It's Mel_Fam_1. You can't miss me. I'm perfect. Right there.
Perfect. We have many TikToks to look forward to. They're the perfect thing to make during quarantine. Yes. Is you can make hundreds and thousands of them. So, and they're all fun. Yes. Awesome. We need to get Panda a TikTok. I just had a great idea. Panda needs a TikTok. I'll see what I can do.
This time you wear it.
Yeah, I was going to say, this time I'm going to wear the costume. I'm going to sweat for the craft.
Yeah, you're not going to like it.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, everyone be sure to check out Melissa on social media. Keep up with what she's doing. Thank you for listening to this episode of Convincing Creatives. As a friendly reminder, you can see Melissa and Panda Barrett as Panda coming to Amazon Prime this fall. We're also an official selection of the Charlotte Film Festival. We just found that out recently, so we're very excited about that. And we have much more to come, so keep up with us at Panda Bear It Film on Twitter and Instagram, and you can find Panda Bear It if you just search it on Facebook. There's a whole page for the film, and you can keep up with us there. Thank you again for joining us, and stay tuned for the next episode of Convincing Creatives. Thanks, everyone.